The Anatomy of Change, A Way to Move Through Life's Transitions, by Richard Strozzi-Heckler, narrated by Kirk Magoon, published by North Atlantic Books. Forward. This is a book about holistic education. It is also about the mind-body schism in today's crazy world. But it is much more than that. It examines in simple terms the very roots of aggression and violence in our global societies, and our failure to learn the law of love. Thus, it is an important book. The fact that there are buttons that can now be pushed to self-destruct the world is a clear reflection of the tension and inner struggle happening in the lives of billions of ordinary people. The architects of our society is everywhere. That tension is cultural. Culture has always been the product of the individual human organism. Society is made by individual people who form groups. In addition, every person is a composite functioning of two simultaneous processes, the mental and the physical. So it seems important, in our search for both self-knowledge and knowledge about our societies, to examine the relationship between these two aspects of ourselves, the mental and the physical. Richard Heckler investigates this relationship and how, although falsely, they often appear perpetually antagonistic to each other. He suggests that the careful examination of how you go about living your life on this planet is a high priority if you're interested in living sanely. It is only by knowing exactly what is true about our own nature that we can come to an understanding of our penchant for harming ourselves and killing each other. This book examines our cultural tendency to be preoccupied with the thinking, fantasy, or mental functioning, and our lack of appreciation for, and interest in, the subtle rich life of the sensory or body function. The imbalance cuts us off from viewing the world as it truly is. Instead, we each have our own personal fantasy world. We exploit sensation and the body out of greed in that personal world. We commercialize the body, but we do not acknowledge the body as a source of learning, an ever-present source of information about ourselves. In that way, the more gentle, the softer feelings like love and tenderness go unnoticed. This seems to be the condition of international politics today. The symptoms of the condition are fear and mistrust on all sides. The cause can be found in our deep mistrust of our own bodies. We have mistrusted the aspect of our lives where love is truly born. Love is a feeling, and we cannot feel it as long as we devalue the body's most subtle messages. C.G. Jung made testimony to the same observation when he wrote that there are two basic polar forces in the world, the feminine principle and the masculine. His alarm for the world's condition stemmed from our devaluing of the feminine principle and the glorification of the masculine. We tend to place high value on rational thought, achievement, and goal-oriented action at the expense of that part of our experience that is not rational, namely feeling, intuition, and emotion. The latter are sensate phenomena. They are qualities that can only be appreciated through the medium of the body, which offers its information via sensation, often in very subtle ways. In this book, Richard Heckler is writing about the need for balance in our collective psyche and in the physical environment. He points to self-awareness as the tool for attuning ourselves to the world. He is suggesting, in a straightforward way, that we must re-educate ourselves and that we must change our educational institutions to do so. The change in our orientation to life and education must be a radical one. His work, and the work of the Lomi School, of which he is co-founder, has been, for the past 15 years, a systematic exploration of new methods of holistic education. That work addresses directly the need to awaken appreciation for the treasures of information the body offers. I have had the good fortune to work with Richard Heckler in developing the curriculum and the teaching at Lomi School. For a long time, we have been friends and have shared the same vision. Both the friendship and the vision have never faded. It is a vision of a world where bodily life itself becomes the very ground for mutual respect and caring in human relationships. This book is Richard Heckler's offering toward the realization of that vision. It is a rich offering, full of wisdom and understanding that can only be acquired from experience and disciplined effort. His excitement and inspiration shine out of his words. Excitement and inspiration are the qualities of a good educator. Robert K. Hall, M.D. Lomi School, Mill Valley, California. Preface. My primary process of perceiving is muscular and visual. Albert Einstein. I come from the tradition of the bodily arts. As a young boy, my early education emerged from the many playgrounds, gyms, basketball courts, and judo classes I discovered in the various places where I grew up. In those environments, I found meaning for my life and respect for my peers. To be a player meant acceptance, fellowship, and an identity as someone who had something to offer. That world also offered the dream of rising out of playgrounds and into the big time. The dream was rarely shared openly, but when we all got together, it surfaced from our collective unconscious in the nicknames we gave each other and in the ways we emulated those who had made it. Our games and play held the promise of rising above the average, of doing more than just pumping gas at the local station or ringing up sales at the liquor store. Later, as I became more involved in the world of organized sports, I learned about working together with teammates toward a common goal. It was in this world of running, jumping, throwing, catching, hitting, risking, and making contact that I also learned what everyone learns in a bodily art. There is a real and important difference between what people say they can do and what they actually do. With this understanding, I took as my teachers those who could embody what they said. I began to learn how to distinguish between those who knew things and could say them, and those who could do those things and be them. I watched how people moved, how they corrected for their mistakes, how they responded in pressure situations. I saw that anyone could talk a good game and that it was easy to criticize from the sidelines. But all that became just chatter when the game started. I began to recognize a certain quality of presence in those who were both concentrated and relaxed with what they were doing. I learned that the reality one made for oneself came from actions and putting words on the line, not from idle boasts. In the martial arts, we say, put it on the mat, which means to take your philosophy and see what it looks like in action and deed. This continues to be a guiding principle for me, and I feel grateful for having learned it so young. In the summer before I entered high school, I fractured my knee playing baseball. After the cast was removed, I was encouraged to run and lift weights to strengthen the leg. I continued running and won a track scholarship. I became the first person in my family to go to college. By the time I finished my undergraduate studies, I had been running competitively for over 9 years. Among many other things, those years taught me the value of practice and discipline. This was the second important principle I learned from the bodily arts. If we practice and apply ourselves, it is possible to change, grow, and be transformed. During my years in college, I also experienced a crucial and confusing separation in my life. I moved in two different and separate communities, but never felt entirely comfortable in either one. One was the world of the mind, and the other, the world of the body. The frustrating distance between these two worlds was, in many ways, what initiated the journey that has brought me to this book. As an athlete, I delighted in the aliveness I experienced in working with my body. My memories are those of bright sun on my back, the feeling of nervousness before a race, the smell of freshly cut grass during workouts, the heaving breaths that reached my socks after a hard race, the feeling of satisfaction after exerting myself completely and wholeheartedly. Those experiences added a passion and vividness to my life. At the same time, I found very little inspiration from the locker room crowd. I enjoyed the camaraderie, but something was missing. I felt that I was more than just an organized group of muscles training to win a race, and I wanted more. I found some of what I wanted in the intellectual and artistic community. I was inspired to a larger view of the world through literature, poetry, and psychology. But that heady world, with its rarefied atmosphere, often left me stale and with no feeling. I loved the idea and philosophy, but the lengthy discussions in smoke-filled rooms seemed to have nothing to do with living out beautiful ideas. The two communities were worlds apart, yet there was something for me in both of them. So I went to the physical education building to feel my body and to the classroom to exercise my brain. The distance between the gym and the classroom was the same separation that existed between my mind and body. I was an athlete, and I was a poet. But I also felt that I was something more than either one. I felt that if I could discover what the other thing was, the two sides would be united. In seeking something more, I found that the world of traditional psychology and philosophy did little for me with its arid and complex view. I was also reminded that I learned more from people and actions than from concepts. The spiritual communities that I participated in offered something in the way of a practice and structure to live life by, but they also seemed
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.